Signed in?
Yes.
Well, that's up to our COVID.
If you haven't signed in, can you please do so?
Otherwise, Zara will come in.
Otherwise, I'll kick you out of the radio club.
That's right.
Sign in or suffer the wrath of Zara.
It's nearly time. Look, it's fantastic to see so many new people here tonight, and it's also fantastic to see all the ladies here tonight. It's ladies' night here at the club. All you fellas, be on your best behaviour. I'd like to introduce Professor Simone Douglas, who's related to our very endeared Daffy John Douglas. And, you know, lecture coordinator extraordinaire, that sort of thing. Anyway, take it away, Simone.
Thank you very much. Am I live to air on the mic? Is it my audible?
Basically only for the recording.
Only for the recording. Okay. Thank you so much for the invitation to be here, and thanks for the support from the sisterhood. Good to see you all. Dad asked last week if I would give a talk. So I went, yeah, sure, happy to. So this is an interactive talk about a project that I've been doing since 2013, which has involved my father. So you'll get a lot of references to Daffy John Douglas across the years. And that stretches back actually to my childhood, this project. But please feel free to ask questions throughout. I get really bored of hearing myself. So ask anything you want. I didn't realize this was being recorded until this evening. So I've just pulled out the engineering drawings, which are confidential documents. But I'm happy to show them to you after the camera's turned off. So... they're not for sharing yet, until the project goes live. Yeah. So I love always to start with this image, and I'm going to be corrected by no doubt the physicist here in the today. But forgive me, please feel free to correct me if I'm wrong. But this is the
ultra deep field.
Absolutely, it is. Yeah. Hubble Deep Field image, and as I understand it, perhaps the image of the oldest light that we have record of, depending on your belief system. And what I found really compelling about this image was that it's an image that's been traveling across time and space for a span of time far more beyond my capacity to understand time. And here it rests on this plate, photographic plate, and it's captured, and it continues to travel as light out across time and space. So we're looking at an image of the past, the present, and the future. And that makes me think about an indigenous concept in Australia called the every when, also known as the dream time, which means that you're responsible to the past and the present and the future simultaneously. So you can't say the future will happen and the past has happened, all things happen at the same time. And I find this to be a really beautiful kind of evidencing of that, which makes me think about the ethics of my own work. So I trained at Sydney College of the Arts, the University of Sydney, and then went on to UNSW and did a research master's there, and then ended up teaching at both before I went for 2 years to New York as a guest lecturer at Parsons School of Design as part of the New School. And just to give you a little bit of quick history about the New School, it was a radical breakaway from Columbia University 101 years ago. And it was a group of professors on the back of the wars and the depression, the situation in New York at the time, who believed that education should be offered equally. And Columbia, as you know, is a private university, and so they started teaching night classes in Greenwich Village and offering education for free. And consequently, the New School University was formed, and it's a liberal arts university, and it became a university for exiles. So it took a lot of academic exiles from Europe throughout the war periods, and then more recently from Vietnam and Southeast Asia, and now from Afghanistan and Iraq. So it houses an extraordinary group of faculty who are highly motivated because they've come from really difficult circumstances, either they directly or their families ahead of them. And then Parsons School of Design, which is an enormous art and design school, it takes up about 65% of the New School in terms of population. And we also have the very wonderful College of Performing Arts, which houses the famous jazz school. So it's an art and design driven liberal arts university. And we have affiliation with MIT. And that's where we do a lot of work with engineering and physics, and a lot of this work has come out of the solar engineering courtesy of MIT. So that's just to give a little bit of background. So consequently, when I got lucky enough to have be offered a full-time position there, I made the decision to abandon Sydney Uni, which is a wonderful, and I still retain a strong affiliation with it, and moved to New York, which is where I've been for 15 years. In March last year, I came back on my way to Melbourne to chair a conference at UMelb, and COVID happened, and we went online. So I came for 10 days, and a year and 2 months later, I'm still here. The same exciting set of t-shirts for a year. So this is a body of work which was originally called Promise, but is now called Ice Boat. So I'm an artist, obviously, and I retain a strong connection to science. When I grew up, my father had Meccano sets, and we built little radio sets together, and we built solar energy little sailing boats that we travel across the ground using with a little solar cell in it. So that was a really important part of the language of my childhood. And also, Dad, as you probably know, sailed a solo, which is a single-person boat, on what I call inland seas. So we would spend every holiday traipsing in the old car with the army tent out to lakes where they would sail in the state and national titles. And so we had this privilege of running wild in the amazing landscape of New South Wales and Victoria. And this kind of fascination of these inland bodies of waters and the histories around them. So when, as an art student in my early university days, I travelled out, jumped an old Gemini out to Broken Hill, hit Cobar at sunset, and was really compelled by this, I don't know, how many have been out to it that way? A lot of you, imagine. Yeah, right. So that moment in Cobar when the sun hits and you get that sense of the rolling seabed, which I'll never forget, that you're actually in the ancient seabed of the ocean. So we were travelling out to Broken Hill and Tibooburra, and we were up in Tibooburra in Sturt National Park, and there was a beautiful piece of writing in Tibooburra National Park office by Charles Sturt, who, as you know, was a colonial explorer who sailed into the desert looking for the inland sea to find that the lake that he thought that would lead him to the sea was in fact a flood. And much to his great chagrin, must have been the moment when he realised that there was no sea, and in fact he was left in this incredible desert, which were the Gibber Plains of the Sturt National Park, one of the harshest deserts in Australia. And there's this beautiful piece of writing by Sturt as he's out there recording meticulously in his diary every day of his hatred, passionate hatred of the Australian landscape, and of looking at these dry riverbeds and waiting for the rivers and the Bakinji people who were keeping them alive saying, no mate, no water's coming. Like, bit of a different landscape. And he was used to the English landscape in which birds fly inland to water, and in Australia they don't. So he was following the birds, and of course, much to his folly. So the boat that he sailed through the lake, through the floods, up through the river system, through the floods, and dragged them through the last part through the mud, thinking of finally they would cross the mud to the inland sea, came to rest in a sea of black gibber stones. And when I was out there, I was struck by the light. And so the black gibber stones are polished by the winds which come from primarily one direction. So they're like a mirror, a black mirror on one side and umber on the other from all of the red dirt that gets dust that gets caught underneath them. So it's like a black sea, and I imagine this boat just coming to rest in it. And of course, are the fossilized remains of the seabed, which must have been incredibly frustrating for him, and the Great Artesian Basin, where it sunk to. So I was struck by the kind of tragic poetics of that. And I had been working with images of ice in New York, and at that moment I had an epiphany, which was I must build a boat of ice in the desert, and I don't have any better explanation for it than that. And I thought that I would make this boat in the desert and I would film it and it would become a video piece. And a colleague of mine, amazing senior colleague of mine in New York, who did a lot of community work, called me out on it and said, you're not paying attention to community. And that became an absolute like clarion call. Like, I have responsibility, and that's why I raise past, present and future. So what is the story of Sturt, and what is our story of our collective futures? I went to visit Aunty Maureen, who's the Bakinji matriarch there, and spoke to her about it and said, I really want to do this project on the land out here, the living desert, which is belongs to the Bakinji. And she said, I'm really angry. And I was like, oh, well, here we go. Fair enough. I'm going to have to fall on my sword and pull the project. And she said, no, not with you, but I'm angry with the council because we gave the living desert to the council on a government grant and we gave them our name and they promised to build a welcome center. So anyone who came to the living desert would pass through the welcome center and, you know, get to read some of the stories of the Bakinji and whatever the Bakinji would like to share. And it never happened. And I thought, well, maybe I can utilize the ice boat to raise funds to go to the Bakinji. And other ideas came as this project progressed. So it started from very small kind of moments and became this larger project, which is why it's taken so long. actually have a short video about it, which is excruciating for me to actually watch and hear, but I'm willing to play it. It's like 3 minutes. It was filmed in New York about the project itself. So you up for the video? All right. Never forget the first time, my first encounter with the desert proper, driving out over the back of the Blue Mountains, and that moment of realizing that it was actually a sea floor. It was late afternoon, the light had just come through and it was hitting the rolling form of the old seabed, and then the color that was starting to come through, the redness in the earth. And so I started to get a sense of the force of the landscape and the epicness of what I'd been living in without actually realizing that. I started looking at early colonial work in a very different way and seeing how they couldn't actually see where they were. And I don't say that as a matter of judgment, but just impossibility. That what their experience was so different to where they were that they couldn't come into contact with it. And I was in Tibooburra and I went into this tiny little museum, one-room museum, and in it was this amazing handwritten account of explorers that traveled across the desert during a flood. And what happened was that the flood dried up behind them. They thought they were traveling out in a lake. And they took a whaling boat with them and they became stranded at Tibooburra. And so the account is of the only survivor, which is the 12-year-old ship's boy. And he goes with the indigenous people who attempted to save them, but the others died and he went with them and he turns up in Melbourne 5 years later and goes on to write this account of the futility of traveling across the landscape and the blindness of the European explorers. So that's been sitting in my mind for quite some time and I didn't quite know how to make something of that. And then I've known in more recent times for about 3 years that I wanted to make an epic work made of ice in the desert, and became the collision of the idea of using the boat as the metaphor made of ice in the desert. Be an odd analogy to make, but when I look out the window here and what I've lived in for the past 6 years are these epic glittering structures, and I see the way that light transits across them during the day, and I see the light passing through the canyons, and then I was thinking about the way light tracks across the desert in Australia, and then I was thinking about making something which was really temporal, and the way that there's a kind of temporal but permanent structure to New York, and then I was thinking about the impermanence of time, and so I wanted to make something which was epic but would only be there for a moment in time, which it would in fact be about the collapse of time and space. And so it would not only be a boat, but it would be on a cant as if it had been hit by some larger force, and then it would disintegrate back into the land. So rather than leaving a devastating mark on the land, which the Western culture has done, could it be a more positive thing? And so in working with the National Parks and Wildlife, if I do it at a particular time of the year, across August, September, it will melt back into the land, and in its footprint will come the wildflowers. And so what I hope that it will become is an act of healing as well, which I know is a very utopic idea, but that's the basis of it. Moving on, this is the map that Charles Sturt used, and this was where they thought the inland sea was, like a bladder which kind of came in from the top of West Australia. And you can see he was, you know, tracking out in the hope of reaching it. What was a really amazing part of Charles Sturt's story was that as the 3 months that he spent out there marooned in the desert, he, unlike other explorers of the time, like Burke and Wills, he actually took the advice of the Bakinji and stayed alive and kept all of his men alive, except for one who died of scurvy throughout that period. And he had them, if you go out there, you'll find these very Scottish cairns, and every day they'd have to walk to this hill and drag rocks up it and build these cairns to keep them kind of mentally acute throughout that time. He came, moving from this kind of incredible hatred of the landscape, he came to see it. And an really important epiphany, which is recorded in his diary, is he came to understand that he was on the land in the way that the Bakinji were in the land. And so he made a decision not to continue, but to return to Adelaide and try to instill some form of protection in him. He tried to become what was then called the Governor of Aboriginal Peoples, and of course was nixed by the British government, who had other ideas at the time. And his story took a different tale. He made another attempt to find Lee and Nancy and eventually ended, you know, passed his life in Adelaide. But his is one of the few stories told by the Bakinji as one of seeing each other, I guess, an exchange, and how different our histories, mutual histories, could have been if we'd gone down that pathway. So for those of you that have been out into that landscape, this is the landscape when it floods. And so the desert just fills with this water, and you get the red of the desert running underneath the kind of limey water. And so that's what he sailed into. So I was imagining, this is an illustration by Daffy, John Douglas. I was talking to Dad about the ideas, as we have done ever since I was a child, which includes lying on the roof, flat roof of their house, and looking at the sky at night and trying to work out what gravity was, because my father conveyed it was an equation, and I was like, that surely can't be the end of gravity. What happens if you try to imagine the equation doesn't exist? Can you fall into the sky? So we had lots of conversations, and they were formative to my life and this work. So this is imagining this boat traveling across the landscape and starting to think, how do I make this work? This is where the boat came to rest, or as near to the location as we know. So you can imagine the kind of harshness of existing in that. So I started making a series of sketches and thinking about the landscape. Now, Tipperborough was a bit of a bridge too far in terms of the heat, and at that stage it still had a dirt road, so there was no way to build what I decided would be a large boat made of ice in the desert, which would melt back into the desert and return water to the desert where there was once a water hole, and regenerate the land. And as you know, when you return water to the land, especially with flowers like Sturt Desert Pleas, they seed on the same body of land, and therefore they form more flowers and more regeneration in the future. This is just to give a sense of some of the intersections of our cultures out at Murrawindji National Park, and some of the really beautiful cave drawings left by the Bakinji there, and some graffiti made in the early 19th century over the top, which further kind of made me think about, I have a larger responsibility here. So these are early sketches of what the boat might look like as it disappeared back into the land and regenerated the land. Scale became really important, because out there you can make something really large and it's just a pimple. And so I took aluminium foil and kind of laid it out along the living desert floor. I had permission of the park ranger by then, and both the land council and the Broken Hill City Council, to work out there. And I would go out for months at a time between semesters, flying back from New York and working out what the scale should be. And you can see a tiny person in there, which gives a sense of the actual scale. And then, of course, height. Very scientific early experimentation going on here, a stick and a not very long measuring tape.
I'm going to ask a little question.
Yes, of course, please do, yeah.
How did you work out the scale? Did you do it digitally or mathematically digitally?
I did it, well, in the end, mathematically, yeah, but yeah. To start with, by physical, like being on site and just like rolling out a long roll of aluminium paper, and then after many visits to Broken Hill.
It's quite a great tool to extend the video.
Yeah.
How did you do the mathematics transition to the video?
No, it's a very visual, I understand what you're saying. Sorry, no. So no, not mathematically in that way. It was a very visual experimentation. So
okay.
I'll actually show you photos of...
Perception?
Yeah, I'll show you photos of... Yeah. Probably easier with the photos to have a look at it.
It wasn't an exercise in digitally
filming. No. No, because I really wanted to know how it made sense in the land itself. So all the images that you're seeing, aside from the ones that are really obvious, like the drawings, digital drawings, are actual tests on site. Yeah. So these are drawings on the site itself, and these are pretty much to scale. And by this stage, I was working with an architect, Belinda Koopman, who practices on the upper, actually their offices are up in Avalon.
It wasn't for reproduction, it was for...
Yeah. So how you would experience the ice boat in the end, even though there's been years of experimentation and smaller ice boats made on site, is to come out and visit it. Mm-hmm. However, it will be live streamed into other parts of the world.
That's a lot of
It's an awful lot of ice. It's a it's an Olympic swimming pool full of ice, of water. Yeah, which raised the question of how do you deal with water in an arid landscape? Now, spending time out in community and sitting in numerous pubs and drinking cordial, of course, no whiskey involved. I met a bunch of people out at Broken Hill who were phenomenally generous, surprisingly so, for someone that they had never met before. And one of them was a woman who trained as a nurse and then ended up working in the mines in Broken Hill and had done really well out of it. And so they had this huge block of land, which when you're flying into Broken Hill and you feel like you're flying over a mini Kakadu, it's actually her land. And what she'd done was had water spilling out of a broken pipe from the council, spilling across her land, and council didn't fix it for some reason. And so she decided to repurpose that water by using native organic matter, passing the water through that and forming a sequence of billabongs. And it started bringing in birds. And the elders said, we haven't seen those birds since we were kids. And so how did the birds know how to return? Not even, I mean, generationally, many birds have passed, so they were returning to the water. So the water is reticulated water, grey water, which was cleaned by the organic matter, and it is drinking water standard, and I forget the category for it, but you can drink it there, but you can't bottle it and sell it. So you can't take it off the land, but you can actually drink it and not be sick from it. So she offered the water for Ice Boat. Simultaneously, the council ranger, who's also a custodian of the land, offered to collect water in the living desert, like build a little dam and collect water. And because one of the OH&S issues with this is, if it's a public work, in case a kid or a kangaroo or whatever, any of you decide to go up and lick the ice boat, we have to know that you won't get sick from licking the ice boat. So that was part of, yeah. And also really important to use water which came out of the land in any case. And really interesting to hear that it caused the animals to come back. And I found that when I was doing small tests with the ice boat, which I'll show you in just a moment. By 6 o'clock in the morning, I had multiple animals there on day three. So let me just keep going with this. So I started to make small tests of the ice boat. And this is not the final shape. This is because I'm hand casting the boat. And so it's flat across. The thing will actually be torqued in the end, which I'll show you. So we built some molds, and then I would take them out, freeze them in, firstly in domestic freezers and then industrial freezers in Broken Hill, and take them out into the living desert and film them and photograph them from sunrise throughout the day. And by day three, when I got out there in the freezing cold of winter, I had a collection of birds, a couple of kangaroos, and rather disconcertingly, a large brown snake waiting for the water. And the magpies, cheeky buggers, would actually get on top of the ice boat and chip it to make it melt faster. So, you know, extraordinary, right? Where did that come from? I'm sure there are experts in the field that could tell me that. And so what happened was, is working out what ice does in the sun, and one of the really beautiful things that happened was it actually holds a double sun. So as, don't see it in this photograph, but as the sun sets, you get the actual sun setting and then the sun held inside the ice boat, slightly displaced. I was going in and out of New York and I was thinking, well, how do I was doing a lot of work with the Australian consulate in representing Australia and bringing Australians to New York and helping them when they came across, advance Australia in that way. And so I proposed to the High Line and to Times Square, because at 11:59 at night in Times Square, all the screens go to what's called an art minute and they project an art project. And so I proposed that this would actually be projected for a minute, kind of fake live streamed from Broken Hill into Times Square. And what you would see in the night of Times Square is the rising sun in Australia over the desert. And on the High Line, for those of you that have gone on the High Line, looking to the sunset over New Jersey across the Hudson River, you'd actually see the two suns cross, the setting and the rising suns crossing simultaneously. So that brought me into conversation with Destination New South Wales, but that's an exciting journey in its own right. So I continued to do these tests out on site, at the same time thinking, how do I actually make this manifest in the world, beyond kind of hand-casting it myself. At this time, I was put in contact through a film crew with an ice carver in Sydney, Kenji, and I tentatively emailed him and never heard back. Like, I would like to make a 35-metre, as it turned out at that point, large boat of ice, and I'd love to come talk to you about ice. The legal kind of ice. I never heard back from him. I thought, oh, he just thinks I'm a loony. fair enough. Anyway, if I may address, when Dad was having some treatment in hospital, I was talking to the guy who was making the Kevlar mask and asking him just to make light chit chat, would Kevlar work in a, you know, to make a mold for a large boat made of ice in the desert? And he said, oh, you should talk to this guy, Kenji. That's his mask on the wall and he's just completed treatment. So I was like, I'll write to him one more time. Kenji, did not ratting out the hospital who ratted him out. And he wrote back this time and he said, oh, I've just completed treatment. Sorry, I meant to write back to you. I was like, oh, fancy that. Anyway, I went to meet him, an amazing guy. And so we had a lot of conversations about the formation of water and how to handle it in those situations. So he offered, and this will happen if COVID recedes in time, to bring a sequence of his ice carving mates out from Japan. And we would host a series of workshops in Broken Hill for kids at the same time as the ice boat was made. So also looking at the young population in Broken Hill and the difficulties they face in growing up in those areas. Also, they come into contact with the other form of ice. So it's like, how do we engage kids with future? As it turned out, long story short, there's a government internship program. And so we're able to run around the ice boat because it will be cast on site using solar energy, which I'll talk more about in just a moment. So all of the process will be visible and the kids will be there on site to talk about the project and they'll be able to do internships with green technology, environmental science. And so I've been working with the high school there in relation to how to develop those projects, because while I teach tertiary education, they're the experts in high school and primary education and I need their assistance with this. I also want the kids to own it. I don't want to be out on site giving tours. I want them to tell their story. I got invited to speak on School of the Air up in Tipperborough, which was wonderful. And one of the kids, who's 12, was like, miss. And they'd just been to Dubbo Zoo to see elephants, right? And these kids from Tipperborough were like, you know, their heads were spinning. And he said, I was telling him about ice boat. And he said, up in Tipperborough, there's a replica of Sturt's wooden boat up on stilts. And he said, every night I see the moon set over that boat. And that's all he said. And I thought, I don't know where that kid's going, but somewhere amazing in his life. It was just this kind of observational capacity. So these tests, so it also, every time I go out there, I'm like the rainmaker. I get invited a lot to go out there. And when it rains, it pits the ice. So if it rains when the ice is out there, it will go faster, but it will sculpturally be really interesting. The rate of melt changes from year to year because it's impacted by climate change. And so in a tangential way, this project has relationship to climate change and it becomes a small, if you like, glacier, which returns to a glacial landscape. As it melts, the Sturt desert peas only bloom when there's a lot of rain. And so this is timed to be all going well. The freeze will start this time next year and it will be released from its chamber in July. And then it will take the time that it will take to melt, and that will be contingent on weather patterns at the time and temperature. But that is just slightly ahead of the natural rain cycle, which is August, which is if the Sturt Desert peas are going to come, they're going to come at that time. And so hopefully all going well, as the ice boat melts, it will leave in its footprint a shadow of red wildflowers. And they in turn will seed on the ground, and in a year later, or when it rains again, you'll see the footprint of the boat in the land. So it's a generational garden which occurs. To give a sense of scale, that's if you put the ice boat inside a building, which is an old mining building out in Broken Hill. This is the building. We're going to build a test model inside of this building to see how it goes. Because film crews who said, we can help you fake it. I'm like, I don't want to fake it. It needs to be real. said, you've got to build a prototype otherwise, because anything can happen will happen. So, yeah. This is actually now out on site doing the site tests, and the people out on the site there is the Dr. Ollie, who is the head of emergency medicine at Broken Hill Base Hospital, who became involved in the project, and the mayor, and Stephen, I forget his name, the director of Priscilla Queen of the Desert was out there at the time doing a project in Broken Hill. So there's a whole bunch of people, this amazing community that orbits around Broken Hill. So we took building flashing and we attached it to poles, and these people held it up in the desert as I drove around for quite some hours photographing. That's the scale of it. That's what you'll see as you move around the desert. It's actually visible from space too. We've worked out. As I was filming the ice boat, the small prototypes, it became apparent that it actually follows the heat of the sun. So it actually moves through the day. So it softens towards the sunrise, self-rights, tracks the sun and softens towards the sunset. So in the film of the video, you'll see this kind of slight movement as it disappears back into the land. These are some early drawings about how it might be anchored into the land, and so it has a secret ice keel. So it anchors into the land, and then as it melts back, that's the last part to go. Obviously, it's colder in the land, and hopefully that will hold it as it disappears back. That's exactly the secret winged keel, yeah. But it's an Australian one, of course, yeah. Yeah, and also this means that it doesn't have any impact on the land. So the really important thing is this is a living desert. It's a state park. It was gifted by the Bukinji. And so the site where I wanted to put it, it couldn't go because I was, you know, pointed out that the area has lots of little flints from the stone tools, quartz tools. And so the melting of the boat would disrupt that and it would push them away. So it couldn't go there, very obviously. Although they very generously said I could build a kind of fake land over the top of it. And I'm like, no, I don't want to take the risk of messing with the land. So it's been a lot of like finding the right site for many different reasons and also making sure nothing is left. Inside the boat itself, there will be small clay replicas of the gibber stones, and each of those will have text from the local community about their relationship to land. And as you know, Broken Hill is an incredibly diverse community. It's a mining community. And so people have come from all over the world to seek a better life there, and then also the Bukinji. And so I hope it brings together a united voice about our relationship to land. And so as the boat melts, people will put their stones into it as it's freezing, and then it will disperse those stones across the land with the text, which will be in multiple languages, I don't doubt, with all kinds of messages. And people can take them if they want them, souvenir them, and the remaining ones will be given to Broken Hill City Art Gallery, which is the oldest state public gallery in Australia. Oldest gallery, not just state. So that will be gifted to them as a kind of record. So we, Dad and I were, well, Dad primarily was, as an engineer, was trying to nut out how do we freeze the boat. Now I really want to use solar energy, so this is my big kind of thing. In the meantime, AGL has opened a solar farm out at Broken Hill. 25 kilometres from the site. And unfortunately, a British company has developed this portable solar batteries, so we can port the, instead of building solar cells on site, which would take up like the whole hillside, we can actually port the solar energy from AGL site to
Long extension cord.
Very long extension cord. We did look at long extension cords quite seriously. Yeah.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah, we looked at all kinds of things. I'm happy to talk about the 1 million manifestations this has been through.
Well, we're talking about building one from Northern Territory to Singapore, so.
Yeah, that was along with tilting the land on its side so the water would run from the east to the west coast. I heard, yeah. Yeah.
No, this is still active.
Is it really?
Yeah, for solar power. It's for solar power in Singapore.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. Part of the embryonic conversation was salt conversion as well.
That's in Spain.
Every time I give a talk about this, I come into contact with some other expert who kind of joins the project, so feel free to. It takes a lot of people to make this. In the end, you can have the idea, but you can't build it. It becomes a collaborative community project, and that's really important to me. And so when this is, sorry, Dad.
No, I was just going to say that when we were looking at that initially, we were looking at those coolers that are used on refrigeration vans, mobile refrigeration vans, and they hold 20 degrees centigrade below zero.
Yeah.
But we calculate we need 26 degrees centigrade below zero, so they won't help. I'm trying to do that, and so that drawing's out of date.
It's true, yeah.
But otherwise, it's more, and you can see it's a boat that's 35 metres long, and nearly 7 metres tall at the nose, and 6 metres at the bow, and 6.5 metres wide in the middle. Contains a lot of water,
yeah.
And weighs a lot. And you can't sort of put all the water in the freezer. You've got to put it in layer by layer, just as nature does. You know, the water squeezes up between the ice, flows across the top and freezes, and then the next layer comes up, and then the next layer.
How much water are you talking about? Any rough
Well, it's an Olympic swimming pool full of water, is the actual quantity of water.
Heavy, it's
yeah, and so it's actually going on a rock base.
Right.
Yeah, so going back to, yeah, well, Dad's thinking that through, so that is actually the top, well, it's an old seabed, so that's actually where that's sitting at the moment is, yeah,
so you must
it's
have
rock.
Some estimation to how long it's going to last.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which is shifted.
You kind of blanketing it, you can keep the cold in while you're freezing it.
Yeah. Right, hang on.
Well, that's the trick.
It'll last quite a while.
Well, the rate of melt was worked out. I'm also working with, and they're the engineering plans, which I can show you later, with Richard Matheson, who's a structural engineer. I'm just, the company's just gone out of mind, but they're pro bono. They're one of the big kind of structural engineering companies in Sydney, and they pro bono the Sydney Biennale. So they work a lot with artists because it requires them to problem solve in ways that they don't normally, which in the end helps with buildings when they're working with more kind of radical architecture, I guess. And they've been just wonderful to work with. So I've been really lucky to come into contact with them. And then in New York with another project that I work with off the back of this called Sky Ladder, I work with Arab engineers who engineer the Opera House in their time, same company. Sorry, Dad, you were in the middle of a...
I was just saying that I can't read it. It's up on the top.
That's it, yep. Yeah.
Is that one tanker or multiple?
Well, seven water truckloads, because at one point we were looking at bringing the water up from Mildura. There's Mildura Pink Salt, who had the very nice idea of pulling the salt out of the river and turning it into a product. It was put in there by the farmers. Has all of this water that they've extracted when they've extracted the salt from it. So they were looking at bringing the water up from Mildura at one point. So it's been through many manifestations, which is why there's a lot of, yeah.
So it have to be done an inch layer per day, so it's going to take quite a while. But a mould has to be built, and the mould has to be on top of oil because of the shape of the boat, which means we've got to cheat and have little steps in it.
Yeah.
The way of doing that, that's not a problem. But it is a substantial challenge. I mean, if you put it in a box, you know, it's going to be 40 metres long, 10 metres wide and 8 metres tall. And we've got to maintain that inside of that at 26 degrees below zero. And that's a challenge in itself. It's not impossible.
Yeah. So you can imagine going with that to potential. I've been really lucky with funding in kind, but going to funding bodies, straight cancer, like, we really love the idea, but it disappears. I'm like, that's the whole point. That is absolutely the point. And what it leaves is a residue in the land, which is a generational garden, and that is the thing, not a lump of something somewhere. It's at the point of it is this regenerative force. And what Dad was talking about is like, what can art do? Like, how do I work as an artist with community? What can I bring to community? How can I work with other fields of expertise? I mean, one of the beauties of working in a university, and I know many of you have or still do, connected to universities, is the pure pleasure of working interdisciplinary and calling on other fields of expertise. And that is the joy of it. I mean, I remember going to my first day of kindergarten thinking I was at university for some reason, and thinking, yes, kind of crushed. But it was really, so this kind of, you know, I mean, it's amazing to be in the company of ideas. Like, there's no way I can make this by myself. Absolutely. You can have the idea, but it can't manifest. So I acknowledge all those that work with it. This is actually Daryl Ford, the park ranger, pointing out the ancient fireplaces. These are 7,000-year-old fireplaces. The charcoal's been carbon dated. And so, again, these are things that can't be disrupted with the making of the ice boat. And this is chatting with Daryl, who's a custodian of the land. These are digital versions of what it might look like sitting on the High Line on the digital screen. And so you see that's, as you've been up on the High Line, this wondrous gift to New York, that's the Hudson over to the right-hand side. And as the sun setting, you'll see the sun rise in Australia and they'll cross paths, or vice versa, actually. So it's become this very complex moving project of proposing, making multiple proposals to different things and trying to bring them all into the same time frame. And I was thinking, well, it has this shell that it sits in, that it's the, you know, that's freezing inside of. So what do I do with that at the end? And Aunty Maureen said to me, oh, we don't have any freezers out on our land. I was like, have the freezer. because it will be solar generated, so it'll be cost negligible to run. And then the shell itself, which it will actually be cast inside of, will be tipped upside down. And so it becomes, and I'll show you an image of that in a moment, an inverted kind of cathedral, upside down boat. And that will become the welcome center through which you'll pass through. Yeah, and pure serendipitous that it actually mimics the shade shelters built by the Bakinji as they pass through that land. And as they have conveyed to me, that land was never, it was passed through because it was such arid land. So they passed through from the river areas on their way north. And it had small water holes where you see the petroglyphs of the frogs, like drip water, you will find water here. So the water from this iceberg will actually go back down the hill into those water holes. And that is with the consultation of Badger Bates, who's one of the seniors and also an amazing artist who lives out in the area, who's Bakinji. So this is working with the architect, Belinda Koopman, who also went to Sydney College of the Arts before going on to UTS to do architecture. Working out how do we make a kind of something which can be repurposed. And in the end, it was really simple, which is the actual mold itself, which was, yeah, what my gut instinct had been from the beginning. And as Dav was mentioning, the way it'll be frozen is one small piece of water at a time. And that was Russians build ice bridges that way, which is just small layers of water. And so that those enormous, you know, trucks can pass over them. They're that strong. And they got the technology from noticing that water bubbles up from under underground streams and spills across the land and freezes. So that's where that technology comes from. Just observation, really. And this is just the drawings of trying to work out how it will actually be stabilized in the land while it's freezing. These drawings were done not only to kind of, it becomes this period of like evidencing, how do you evidence something that hasn't been done before? And who do you, where do you gain support for that? And so it became people that are, send people into space basically, where it's about the journey, and sometimes it will work and sometimes it won't, but it's the endeavor. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So there's a lot of engineering plans now, which have been engineered by Richard Matheson to take into account the wind shear factor. He's been out on site and met the council, and so is Belinda. And so there's a really lovely community. Murray Fredericks, who's one of the world's top time-lapse cinematographers, who's Australian, remarkable filmmaker, will actually film the melt of the ice boat. And so that's how we'll get the time-lapse version of the ice boat melting. You may have seen his footage if you watched the ABC Australian of the First 1,000 Years. He does all that kind of high-end doco work where he films out in the far north of Australia through the lightning times and sits under, yeah. Anyway, his story is a pretty amazing one. I don't know whether this will actually play. We'll give it a go.
Do the engineers anticipate it'll be can be just water, like it doesn't need
rear
rod or
anything yeah. inside it? Yeah. Yeah. It'll just be water.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had originally thought of putting ribs in it, and then for reasons of it wanting to disappear completely, took them out.
Better just water.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. No, we've worked it out. So the base has to be a certain kind of footage on the ground.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And it'll be torqued at the top to take in a little bit of the wind, which I'll show you in just a moment. Yeah. This was part of the kind of putting together. When you're describing this to people, you can never be sure that they're seeing the same thing as you, so.
What size have you done this to, just as an
what size is the video done for? Just a full day or just like
a 4K? It's a full, yeah, cinema, yeah. Thanks for asking, though, yeah. So it's no longer going to be made this way, but yeah.
This is one of the design concepts.
This is one of the design concepts, yeah.
Which has been rejected.
Many things have been. It's been many,
how
many
long
working
groups. How long have you been working on this?
2013, I had a sabbatical.
Okay.
And that was like talking to a whole bunch of people about it,
yeah.
Having the idea up in Tipperborough, developing, making some tests out on site, photographing it and going from there. So a lot of things have happened simultaneously. That's the engineering drawings obscured.
Fantastic.
Come back to those. And so developing these kinds of posters and drawings, which I've had amazing conversations with not only Kenji, but the director of the Maritime Museum, who knew there's a curator of inland sea journeys. So I've come into contact with a whole engagement with experts in the history of Australia and those kind of journeys and what they've meant to us. And so at the moment it's been funded, supported by Parsons, my university, through a series of grants and Broken Hill and a whole lot of in-kind expertise. I gave a talk at the, I had to do a presentation at the Broken Hill Potters Society because I wanted to see if they would be interested in working with the gibber stones and helping with the making of those. And I was invited for a weekend out into the country where they camp and they, in swags actually, to sleep outside and then they fire raku. And it was the most amazing experience. Anyway, I was giving a talk about it. And this guy who's just sitting to the left, he's like, oh, I'll take you for a drive. You know, I'll show you where the drop rocks are. I'm like, listen, mate, I know about drop bears. Don't, you know. I know I'm a city girl, but really. He's like, no, really. Anyway, out in the desert are these drop rocks, which were left by the glaciers. So they don't geologically belong to Australia now, but they were left as the glacier retreated and Australia pulled away. So they sit out in the desert. So there's one of the world's leading glaciologists who was a Broken Hill boy who grew up thinking, I must be a glaciologist in Broken Hill, as you do, surrounded by the desert.
And it was very cold in this.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And then came back to Broken Hill and retired there, so you never know who you run into in Broken Hill. But they were all on board with it. It was amazing. Through Kenji, I was taken out to, this is where, what is it, polar bear ice? You know when you go to a servo and you buy those things of ice when you go camp, this is where it's made. This is the guy who's been making them for decades. And they're made and they fall like a waterfall from a really high ceiling. But the reason I went out was to talk to him about how to make ice and spin the air out of it so that it would be glassine, so it would really disappear against the landscape. It will have oxygen in it at the bottom, so it'll be slightly milky to kind of ground it, but it will disappear into the sky. And so he was talking through the technology in relationship to that. They also have massive chambers out there to freeze the ice in, so I've been able to do tests out in their chambers.
Have you thought about the extent to which it will show the colours of a rock?
Yeah.
Diffused through the ice?
Yeah, yeah. Did I have that?
I've noticed the thing, when I visited the glacier glacier bays, some of the icebergs are blue and some of them are green, depending on the extent to which they show the colours of water from below.
Yeah, yeah. It'll pick up, this is like a skin of ice over the top of the rock, but it's we figure that it will be a very red kind of conversation. It'll have that kind of glassine look as it meets the sky, and it picks up the colours of the sky, but it'll pick up the red underneath it. That's the result of all the tests. Sorry for skipping through this. So then people were like, well, you've had a long career in video and photography, and I was like, well, I trained in sculpture, fine, I'll make a wooden version of the boat. This is my senior colleague, Professor Emeritus Don Beccaro, who is currently in Switzerland with a big exhibition of his work, teaching me biscuit joins for anyone who does carpentry. So in 2 weeks, I made, utilizing the university from this kind of testing with bits of wood and steel, this sculpture, which is 12 feet. Yeah. I had to go to American measurements. In America, they still use backward measurements. And so I made this movable kind of skeletal form, which is because I had originally thought the boat would have a skeletal form within it, but it doesn't, it has to disappear. But so I started to work with sculptural forms again. And it's in segments, so it actually jags out across the floor. It can be quite expanded or quite compacted. And with this exhibition, I was Jane Lombard in New York, which was called Sites of Knowledge. I made a small version of the ice boat, which I hand carved in a one of those firms that make, you know, swans for weddings and things like that, and Buddhas in restaurants. And I was speaking to the guy there, and he said that he'd learnt ice carving from Kenji. This is in Brooklyn, under a flyway in Brooklyn. I'm going, you've got to be kidding me. And he teared up. He said, I learnt when I was 12 or 14 and I haven't seen him since. I'm like, magic of FaceTime. Let me put you in contact with Kenji right now. There's the most beautiful like connections that happen through work like this over a long period of time. So this actually melts back into the vitrine. It has a bladder in the vitrine underneath it. And this was in the full force of the American summer in the window, and it lasted 2 weeks, go figure. And so it was a really lovely kind of working proof. This is much closer to the shape it will be, which is more moon-like in the shape of it. And what happened with this form is that it didn't actually break, it just got smaller. Whereas the ones that I've been using, the flat ones, would actually break at the end. One end would inevitably break off as it disappears back. At the opening, really wonderful thing happened. People, of course, were wearing summer clothes and they thought it was glass or perspex. And they're like, why do I feel cold standing next to it? And of course, it responded to the body heat and frosted as people got closer to it and then became more glassine. I'm not sure it's visible here, but there was an air bubble caught inside of it, which I didn't realize. And of course, the rate of melt was faster inside. And so what happened was it became an internalized sea of water with an ice skin around it. And so even on the concrete floors, it was enough to judder it. And that it threw rainbows everywhere, which sounds really naff, but it was kind of great. That happened. So that was the... Of course, in the end, it expanded. The bladder developed a leak, and so I had to take it out the back in the courtyard, where Titanic life finished its life in the courtyard at the back. And at night, through the window, it kind of, in the inverse of the desert, holding the desert, it held, that's New York in the ice boat. Off the back of this project, this is a funded project which is going live to air in El Paso right now in Texas. Another one of Dad's drawings. I forgot to put your name on there, sorry, Dad. I proposed working with it was a grant around COVID and how to help communities that have been really hard hit. And so I proposed a project called Returning the Future. And this is working with Sandros, this amazing First Nation man that lives out there, and he's a third generation bricklayer, but he retrained himself to as an adobe expert, and he teaches young kids how to make buildings out of straw and clay in the traditional ways. And so I had proposed that I wanted to make these small, which could be made by individual members of the community, filled with seeds of the wildflowers from out there, placed on the land, and they would just over time, they would form their own kind of garden and they would flower, they'd become flowering boats and disappear back into the land over the years, unknown period of time. A really lovely man out there who runs the local rubbish tip offered the land on the rubbish tip because he does a lot of recycling and he wanted to regenerate land. So this is putting the vegetation back in the land where it was taken out. Oh, so First Nation way of making buildings out there is to use clay and more organic matter like straw. And so there's a certain amount of expertise to make buildings that will stand up rather than, yeah. So traditional, he's a traditional architect. Yeah, architect trained in traditional methodology, sorry, beg your pardon. Now I was supposed to be there to help make it, but COVID says no. And so now that's been developing a whole different thing of recording his expertise and making videos of his expertise, which can be then archived, and making kits which could go to people's homes so they could make it individually and then take it out onto the land one by one. We were going to make it all together. So that's been a pivot. Another project that came out of this is Sky Ladder, which essentially is a ladder of reflective metal plates which disappears into the air. And on one side you'll see the sky and on the other side you'll see the land on the inverse, and one disappearing into the other. And we did a whole lot of sun tests. I worked with an Australian student, Leela Shankar, who was studying architecture and lighting design. Part of my role as a faculty is an internship and mentoring program, and I have opportunity, I always work with students. It's always a wonderful process. And so I invited her to work with this, and it became, with me on this, a wonderful process. And we would go down to the Hudson and hold up pieces of reflective metal and photograph it and see how it operated. And then we went to Arup in New York, and they engineered how that would actually stay in the land. So again, that got a little bit delayed with COVID, but that's active. That's all the images of Ice Boat. So that was a bit of a fast forward. Oh, Sky Ladder was projected for Broken Hill and then put on hold. That would be actually had to be anchored in the ground with concrete. But it would only be temporary for a couple of months and we'd take it out. But it can go anywhere. So Desert X, which is a big festival in Texas, is really interested in Sky Ladder. So that's not so tied to the story of the land. I've been offered, I could have made Ice Boat like 10 times over in America with the support there, but the story belongs to here. And so therefore it has to happen here. It actually has a partner boat, which is due to happen in Sydney, and that's why I've been working with the Maritime Museum, the conversation's on hold at the moment. which will be made of electromagnetic rods, which pull moisture from the air. And so as one boat disappears, the other skins itself together, building a ghost shell of the ice boat, so evolving and devolving conversation. Oh, 2013 was when I had the idea to make it, but it's evolved a lot over those years.
So this will be open to the public?
Yes, absolutely. The building, everything will be open to the public. It's in a state park. I was offered to put it on private land at Broken Hill, which would have made it easier to do, but they wanted to charge an admission fee, and I was like, no, this belongs to the public. So the way the money, the council, amazing general manager out there, projected that this would raise between 15 and 20 million for local community. Because I'm full-time faculty, I'm not drawing anything off here. The people who work on it need to be paid to work on it. So I've been very fortunate with voluntary kind of like people who do have full-time jobs, architects and engineers giving their time to it. But the people who'll be doing the labor of making it need to be paid. And I don't want to draw on voluntary labor for that. So, all the money goes back to community.
Start to completion, how long is it going to take?
From the build to completion, the build and the freeze is ETA 3 months. But solar technology's pushed a lot in that time frame. So
ATO's donating all the electricity for that?
Yeah, sorry, again, say?
ATO's donating all the energy for that?
Well, we hope they are. Yeah, it's a lot of things in conversation, yeah.
Because even if you have no losses, you're talking almost 400,000 kilowatt hours.
I know, yeah.
I'm just doing some science.
No, thank you. I appreciate it. No, that's all good. No,
that's just to make the water cold enough to minus 26,
yeah.
Regardless of losing any of the heat.
Yeah. And then there's the material that it has to be put in to retain, as you were quite rightly pointing out before. So there's a lot of moving pieces. So Destination New South Wales has been involved in it. It's like anything that hasn't been done before. It's like a really big, amazing challenge to bring people along with you. And what I keep saying to them is, this is about bringing something back to community. It's showing issues of environment and regeneration through a different, like, people can look at data. Sometimes data means nothing to them, but you can show it in a different way. Like Foucault's pendulum, right? I'm sure you all know Foucault's pendulum, many people here. Yeah, right, so you just simply change your perspective. It's the same thing, but it has a completely different way of coming into being. So that's what this project's about as well. Is bringing that into being. So the funding will come through obviously tourism and also through workshops and other affiliated events, which the Broken Hill will be able to license. And ideally the money will go, Bukinji will determine how they use the money, but it will also go to education and the flying doctors and the amazing services that are made available to make our regional communities exist and thrive. And there's an amazing, I've come into contact with forget his last name, but the guy who directed Priscilla, Queen of the Desert. We started working on a urban regeneration project, which I did with my colleagues who work in architecture at the new school at Parsons. Now, it was a government tender, and so we knew we couldn't get it because we were an international tender, but we did it in order to work with a group of Australian architects, heritage architects, to push those ideas along. And that was urban regeneration. It was called Line of Load, Line of Land, Line of Stars. As different kind of navigational ways through Broken Hills and regenerating. Now that funding went, that was a controversial thing in the end, so I'll go no further with that on camera. So there's like an incredible community, which I keep saying, but yeah. Any other questions, thoughts, contributions? Thank you for the kilowatts, yeah.
Yeah, when I first heard about this project, struck me that it would be interesting from an engineering point of view, but just seeing how it's spread out across all the multiple disciplines and all the community benefits and all that. It's like the water melting from the boat itself, spreading out in places that you have any control over. It's a very interesting metaphor, the way it's working out like that. It's just amazing.
We don't know. Like, anything can happen. Like, maybe it'll break off its anchor and go down the hill. So all of that has to be, there's going to be some nightmare moments, right? Or it doesn't freeze, or it's kind of jelly. I'm a realistic optimist, and you've got to take into account. It's just we have to run with and change as it happens. So everything will be visible. Ideally, the water will just cascade down the hill on either side. There are rock channels where the water used to go when the rains came more frequently and moved down into the water holes where you see the petroglyphs. And Badger Bates was like, that water has to go back to the animals, and so we're going to build little channels, and that's his expertise on how that can happen.
If it doesn't freeze, you can make a big jelly.
That's true. We'll just put some like red flavouring in there. Like have a what is it, like a smoothie kind of crushy thing. Yeah. Well, they're slushy, that's it, thank you. Yeah, that would be, yeah. So there's been a whole lot of testing. Like I'm talking lightly over the surface of many years of testing and expertise to make sure that this can happen. But that said, as you know, when things haven't been done before, it's a risk. But if you don't take the risk, then what's the purpose? Yeah.
We're going to do it during winter.
Right? Oh, yes, yeah. So this time next year is the ideal. It was nearly live to air 1 year, then we had the drought. And I had the water had, as I said, been donated, but the controversy would have been, you can imagine the Daily Telegraph, cows dying because artists use water on the land, even though that water, cow shouldn't be out there on that land. And, you know, it would just be utilized in ways that wouldn't be helpful to community. It's a political...
Transporting the batteries, there's a whole lot of trucks that are going to be...
Yeah, I know. There's lots of carbon issues associated with it. And so there's still a kind of backwards and forwards about between placing solar cells on site, which get given back to community to use in their own. As you probably know, Broken Hill has become a heritage town and is mainly solar energy now anyway.
There's a company just south of Newcastle that's making battery-powered prime movers.
Oh, really?
Yeah, for trucking between Sydney and Melbourne.
Oh, wow.
And they're setting up an infrastructure for actually interchanging the batteries in these prime movers so they can keep the trucks moving.
Extraordinary. I need to find out.
A week or two ago.
Okay, I'll find it. Thank you. I mean, technology has shifted radically, so the rate of freezing should be fast enough. You're quite right. No, you're quite right. There's lots of... in my dream, it would be carbon neutral, but that's not possible. It can simply push that conversation along, I think. Yeah.
I just wanted to mention that it's a big boat, you know, and the mould is big, and it's high, and it's going to be difficult to pull off, you know. We put the leak stage on, it's probably have to use air bars for someone to pull it off. But there's the problem of handling it, and looking at the possibility, we wanted to sort of pull the covering away during the night, you know, so that the sun appears. Looking at pulling the building down, which would be made of sections and then taken down a little bit at a time, dropped down, folded back on itself, with motor assisted joints so that it would, made possible.
Boy, that's...
I mean, there's a whole range of stuff you can do. It's all doable. It's just a matter of getting a team on it and having the money.
But you have a time frame too. This is the problem, isn't it? You really can't... It's not trial and error. It's going to have to work the first time.
Yeah, well, we'll do a prototype beforehand.
In the shed,
And if it can't happen next year for whatever reason, because COVID extends outwards and it won't generate the kind of funding that it would be beneficial to community, then it gets pushed by another year. So that's the...
But there's also the situation that your experimentation within the shed may also...
Absolutely.
...fail.
Yes.
So it may be pushed back.
That's true. That is true, yep.
It's almost like the early days of amateur radio, isn't it? The experimentation with propagation and... Something similar.
Yes.
Because they didn't know what was going to happen.
Exactly. Like it more, there's been some wonderful, this is you actually inside, this is effectively would be the inside of the mold upside down as a welcome centre to give a sense of kind of...
Instagram for this, or a Facebook, or something to follow?
It's being rebuilt and about to go live again. I took the kind of COVID quiet time to...
Well, make sure you listen to reflect
back. Yeah, it's a little bit on my... there's a little bit on my website, which is just my name, simone.douglas@info. But there's not a lot because it's been under kind of... aside from talks like this where I'm happy to share, it hasn't been made super public. The idea is public, but there will be, there's a lot of this stuff that will be now available as it gets closer, and there's a kind of great documentary crew who've been filming the conversations with community and I mean, the women in the pottery group are extraordinary. The woman who chairs it, she's a farmer, and in her spare time, she has this whole kind of key ring of keys, and she goes around and she picks up all the abandoned cars in Broken Hill and jump starts them and gets them back to the property and rebuilds the cars and donates them to young people who are short of a car and need cars to kind of get to work. Like phenomenal kind of expertise out there and the capacity. Like when I went to this, you know, are they going to absolutely think I'm crazy? I want to do this. And nobody batted an eyelid. It was like, okay, so what can we do to, you know, so that sense of like anything can happen because they have to. That's simply the way they've been living and had to deal with, contend with all kinds of scenarios. So in a way, it's been a lovely kind of match of community.
So is there any further questions? Well, Simone, that would have been, I'd say that's one of the most interesting lectures we've had in a long time and quite different from the usual electronics type A, you know, we put this together and it all works sort of lecture. So that's really amazing. And as a token of our gratitude.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you. Oh, wow.
And we're never going to look at John as the same ever again. You know, you've gone and ruined
thank you very much. Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. That's really lovely. Thank you.
And why did we keep you a secret so long?
I'll quickly share the engineering drawings if you want to, but when the camera's flicked.
All right.
It's only two. I've only brought two along, but I know that the technical interest.